So I still try to check out tech that I think is interesting and cool, and this one's been pointed out to me a few times from some comments that I should review it. It's a mini PC called the AMR5, but they market it as a gaming mini PC. It's powered by the AMD Ryzen 5, the 5600U. That's a 15 watt part, so we're not off to a really good start for a gaming mini PC. However, they have set a higher power limit. We do have a little dial at the top of it to change our different modes. So we've got a silent mode, auto, and a performance mode. And because it's marketed as a gaming mini PC, of course, it does have some RGB bling on it. You can see, and you can cycle through that with the settings, with the software that is included. So configuration wise, it does come with 16 gigabytes of RAM and 512 gigabytes of SSD storage. That is NVMe, so PCIe 3.0 spec, full spec Type-C port, display port, HDMI, all supporting up to three monitors at 4K 60. It even has a Wi-Fi 8X. So that's good to see, Wi-Fi 6 support. What does it sell for? Well, around about $500. So is it worth that price tag? And is it really a gaming mini PC? Let's find out. So here's what the outer box looks like. You can see it's a very different looking mini PC gaming style one. So just slip this off and we'll take a look at what we get included. So the R5 here, presentation wise with the box, very different from what we typically get and a little bit bigger here. So there is a user manual that's in various different languages, just showing you where you can upgrade the RAM and how to slot it in, how to take off the side of it. But I will show you that too, go over all of it. So these are the key features of there, that it does have the power switching modes on it. You're basically just adjusting the power limit for it. So silent mode, auto mode, and a performance mode, dual channel RAM, and a dual SSD slot that, yeah, we all kind of know about. So just a protective bit of foam there on the top. There is the mini PC. So it's actually smaller than what I thought it was going to be, because, I don't know, in the box it makes it look kind of big, doesn't it? So here we do have a HDMI cable, okay, so that's a standard kind of length one. Good that they do include that. Our power supply, so a little power supply brick, and this is rated to 65 watts, well, just under there, and then, of course, the power cable for it. So how do we access the internals? Now, this is really good. I like this design because we've just got magnets that keep this top on. You pull it up, and it simply just slots out like so, giving us easy access then to the other PCIe 3.0 slot. When you first power on this R5 mini PC, it just goes straight into Windows. Now, this is something for security reasons, obviously, that I don't like, because it could be that someone could have installed something, whatever. But I would probably do a factory reset to start with. But it does have this, a folder, which is for the RGB lighting. So if you do want that or you don't want that, this is the app you need to then just simply switch and turn it off. So you've got breathing option, you can cycle through all the different colors or rainbow. That's it. So not a lot. Personally, I would just turn that RGB bling off. But hey, it's up to you, of course, if you want that. So for free memory, we do have 15.4 gigabytes because a little bit's allocated to, of course, the Vega 7 graphics with its 7 cores. And I'll get on to the gaming performance later on. You can see currently I'm in the power mode too, by the way, with the switch. I'll leave it in the performance mode the whole time. 44 degrees so far, but I'll be monitoring those temperatures. And the RAM is running at the correct speed, which is good. So we do have Wi-Fi 8X with this mini PC, which is the faster wireless, which gets over gigabyte speeds. It's from Realtek, so that's great. And the disk drive, I'll get onto the benchmarks of this mini PC just after this, is an ASINT, that is that SSD. Of course, you can put your own PCIe 3.0 SSD in. You can expand upon the storage. You'll see the Ryzen 5, the 5600U, shows up here 12 times. That's because it's got 6 cores and 12 threads in total. This is a fast mini PC. Everything I do loads in quick and snappy, and you'd expect that with a PCIe 3 spec SSD and of course the 6 cores and the kind of power that this APU does have. So those speeds there for PCIe 3, they're slow, the writes are a bit slower, but this is still faster than SATA 3. So it's okay. Of course, you can upgrade that, put in your own faster, say Samsung 970 Evo if you wanted a little better. So documents, spreadsheets, basic computing, all really quick on this. I will not be covering any of that,
But here are some benchmarks. There's just a few of them here that I want to show you. So you can see Geekbench 5, a decent multi-core score thanks to the 6 cores and the 12 threads. This is good performance. Single core score won't be as great as the Intel's, which is important with gaming, but then again, it doesn't have a dedicated GPU. It's Vega graphics. So the Vega graphics here, you can see it does perform reasonably well. For integrated graphics, it's getting a good score. This is a decent score, and you can compare and run this benchmark to your own system. So it's the Night Raid 3D Mark benchmark. Firestrike is well here too, that you can get with the free version. For integrated graphics, it's a good score. Now, if this had a dedicated GPU, I would be a bit disappointed. Physics score, again, quite good there. Cinebench, this is the last synthetic benchmark I will show you. There's no need for me to continue on with a whole bunch of them, but you can see, again, a decent score. It's not bad for a 6-core APU that this does have. So what about video playback? Now, because it's running Windows 10, well, it didn't have codec support out of the box, so I've installed VLC player, which this should then open up. Okay, I need to select it here. So these are some demanding video files just to see what the playback is like. Now, this shouldn't lag, but it always does that. Even with the default Windows player, the initial load up of this demanding 140 megabit file does do that. You can see just a few little stutters and lags. Otherwise, the performance is quite good, and that's the Vega graphics, of course, that's handling that. So stepping it up now to 4K 60 frames per second. Ah, yeah, that's why it wants me to buy the codec. No, thank you, Microsoft. I know there's a way to do that to get it actually for free. But anyway, let's just try it with VLC. All right, that is looking really good. No stutters in the beginning. That was 60 frames per second. So that's looking good. That's good performance. The Vega graphics, again, just handling all of that pretty much with ease. No real problem playing those files. How about streaming 4K 60? A surprising amount of chipsets do choke on this because it is quite demanding. Now, this is through Chrome. I will just enable here our stats for nerds, and we'll see what's going to happen. Is it going to drop frames? So I can see it's dropped 24 already, and looking reasonably stable with the occasional drop frames per second. But just looking at that video, do you notice it? Not really that much. Look, is it just 40 then? Okay, it takes a while. So it's not constant frame dropping, but it does happen randomly now and then. It seems to stabilize now a little bit. Ooh, more, but then it just suddenly dropped a whole bunch then. So not perfect, but I would still say this is watchable. Now this I really do like, and that is the speed through the Type-C port. Now this is limited by the internal drive. It's only writing at about 800 sequentials, so it could actually be a lot faster than this. So good speeds through the Type-C port. Great to see that's not crippled, and that Type-C port does support 4K 60 video out. You can run three displays with this mini PC. Finally on to gaming. After all, they do market this as a gaming mini PC, so I wanted to test out could it actually game and play titles that are really demanding, extremely demanding, like this game, which is Cyberpunk 2077. Now I do have it set to 720p. You could go a little bit lower on the resolution, but it's going to look like garbage. I think 720p is okay. I am, of course, on the lowest settings, but I believe there are other ways to actually lower it down even further. So you're getting close to around a PlayStation 4 level here of performance, and that is 30 frames per second with some clear screen tearing and some dips and things. So the performance is not amazing, but considering look at the population density and how many cars are here and all being rendered, it's not doing bad. Now, if the GPU wasn't throttling, it would maintain 1800 megahertz the whole time. And you can see that it is actually dropping here down to 1675, so a little bit of throttling taking place. The power usage has dropped from about 25 watts just down to 19 right now. Gaming performance with GTA 5 now is looking good, very playable here. This is 1080p normal settings, and I'm using basically the same save points that I always test out. Now, I've seen the Vega 8 graphics, get up to around 70 frames per second with higher power limits, of course, set at 54 watts. So you can see that occasionally it does dip down at 1800 megahertz to 1662. So there's the occasional little bit of integrated graphics throttling happening there, especially when I'm firing things and stuff. There's a bit of a frame dip there too. So performance is, it's good. It's playable, definitely playable here, an older title like this. So for old games, yes, you could call it a mini gaming PC, but you know, it doesn't have the dedicated graphics, of course, in this, so it's not very powerful. So just stick to these older, lighter titles and you should be fine for gaming. And here are the thermals. So I have been pushing it hard with gaming, benchmarks, things like that. It gets up to 94 degrees. It does not trigger any thermal throttling, which is good. Fan noise, yes, you hear it. I would describe it as being basically like a gaming laptop's CPU fan. That's really it, okay? It does run a lot quieter if you use silent mode or the auto mode. You'll still hear the fan cycle on and off. That is really it. So not bad. The thermals, okay, could be better. And I really think with this temperature here, you cannot really push the power limit. I would not increase it in the BIOS from the stock auto setting of 25 watts. If you go to 34, 54, it will end up, I think, rebooting itself because it'll just simply get way too hot. So just keep it all at the standard power limits unless you mod the cooler in there. Now to get into this BIOS, you just need to tap delete or F2. I typically just smash away at both of them when I'm powering on the system, then you get straight into this menu. So advanced tab, chipset, everything is open to us. Completely unlocked BIOS, be very careful in what you change in here. If you don't know what you're doing, just leave it. You got RAM disk configuration, great if you install a lot of RAM. Imagine you install 64 gigabytes or 32, you can make a small little RAM disk for caching files and things like that, temporary. Of course, when you reboot, you lose it. We've got this right here, AC power loss options. So if you want to see all of that, just quickly pause the video. And then we do have these settings here. So MBIO common options is basically the menu that most people will want under advanced settings. Graphics configuration. Now, this is normally auto. I have it set to UMA game optimized. Now that is dedicating 4 gigabytes to the Vega graphics, which does, there's videos out there, help the average frame rate, especially the lower frame rates, just to boost them up a little bit. So that's why I've done it. You can also try different options. Never set iGPU disabled. You run into huge problems. Or auto, but I would just leave it on auto there for that, for most people. Now, if you want to increase power limits, I don't recommend this because the cooler cannot handle it. I've tried and tested this. System configuration, I will leave it on auto, which is 25 watts maximum. Power consumption, sorry, the maximum TDP, so power limit. And you can either experiment with 35, it might be able to do it depending on what you're doing, but I think you'll run into thermal throttling. So that is on auto for me.
As for Linux support, of course, I did boot a live pen drive image and that was Linux Mint. It did work fine, so that's good. So the ports will at least allow us to boot Linux distros. However, I ran into driver problems with Linux Mint. I probably do need to look to another distro, one that's got a more complete driver package to not have those issues. So let's go over the pros of it. Form factor, definite pro. I like it. I like the look of it, actually. It's got RGB, and you can just turn it off if you don't like it. It's got the little switch for what is basically different power modes there, so performance, auto, and then silent. I would just leave it in performance, of course, if you want the best performance out of it. It does perform quite well. It's only a 15 watt part, but in the performance option there, it's configured to 25 watts. It's got a fast NVMe SSD, well, relatively fast, faster than SATA 3, of course, and everything was very quick and snappy. Video playback was good. It can handle 4K 60 streaming. So if you me playing like YouTube, like I did with my little example, then it will drop a few frames. But overall, it doesn't completely ruin the experience. Now, running 3 monitors out of this is good. The full spec Type-C port at the front and 4 USB ports there. That's all quite good. I love how easy it is to upgrade. You simply just pull that panel off and you can put more RAM in. So you can swap out the 2 sticks of 8 gigabytes and put in 2 16 or 2 32s. And then we can add another SSD. Not a problem to do so, is very simple. And let's see if I can just get that lid back in. It hooks into the bottom and it sits in place. So build quality is quite good. out of it. So the cons. Fan noise, it can get a little loud. It sounds a bit like a gaming laptop when you are gaming, and it's being pushed very hard with things like Cinebench benchmarks really stressing it out. It did show and exhibit a little bit of throttling when it came to the Vega performance in games. Now, that was to do with the temperatures, I believe. So we saw the clock go from 1800 megahertz, which is where it should sit the whole time at its maximum performance, to drop down sometimes to about 1600, 1650, which I don't really like to see. That's just a minor thing, but it will affect the performance a little. Now, the BIOS is completely unlocked, so you could experiment with just adjusting that to see if you can get away with running 35 watts in your favorite games at slightly better frames. And you could dedicate, as I did, more RAM to the Vega graphics instead of having it being shared RAM. Well, it's all shared RAM, of course, but instead of having it scaling up and down, you give it that fixed 4 gigabytes or fixed 2 gigabytes if you wanted to. The other, which is more of a personal thing and probably not a problem for a lot of people, is I didn't like the fact that when I booted it up, it just went straight into Windows. There was no setup to go through. So for security reasons, I do recommend that you just do a complete fresh install. But first, copy over that folder with the RGB setup drivers, the controller for it. So you can turn the RGB on or off, or whatever you want to do, you can adjust that, which is good. So it sells for $500 US. Is that a fair price for a 5000 series AMD APU mini PC? I don't think it's bad. I wish it was, of course, a little cheaper, but overall, I like it. It's a good little mini PC, and if you're going to be playing light titles, as I showed you, you can game on this. So if you desperately need hardware to be just to be, well, only just playable, play, for example, Cyberpunk 2077, you can scrape by with just 30 frames per second at 720p, but other games, as I showed you, older titles, but reasonably modern, well, GTA 5 is quite old now, you run at 1080p with a good kind of frame rate and more stable, you can adjust and tweak settings. So the golden rule with integrated graphics, as always, as I mentioned in a lot of my videos, low settings, lowest possible, and low resolutions to get the playable frame rate. So it's not, I wouldn't market this as a gaming mini PC. They have, it isn't, it needs a dedicated GPU if I was gonna call it a gaming mini PC. So there we go, that's the full story of the AMR5 gaming mini PC. Thanks a lot for watching.